Hello and welcome. Today we will discuss management of burn injuries. Burn injuries are associated with substantial morbidity and mortality. Severe burns can cause an immune and inflammatory response, metabolic changes and distributive shock that can lead to multiple organ failure. Burn injuries affect not only physical health but also mental health and quality of life. Recovery from burn injury involves addressing long-term alterations to optimize quality of life. Burn care providers face challenges in acute and critical care management, long-term care and rehabilitation. According to a study on burn patients admitted to an intensive care unit, factors such as age, female gender, total body surface area burned, mechanical ventilation and acute renal failure were all associated with mortality. The ICU mortality rate was 32.8% and hospital mortality was 34.1%. In India, there are 1,339 beds for burn patients, with 297 of them being in ICUs meant exclusively for patients with critical burn injuries. Burn depth is an important factor in assessing patient care needs and, in particular, surgical needs. In general, the deeper the burn, the more challenges there are to achieve good scar outcomes. First degree, superficial thickness, affecting the epidermis only. Burns are typically benign, very painful, heal without scarring and do not require surgery. Burns extending into the underlying skin layer, dermis, are classed as partial thickness or second degree. These burns frequently form painful blisters. These burns range from superficial partial thickness, which are homogeneous, moist, hyperemic and blanch, to deep partial thickness, which are less sensate, drier, may have a reticular pattern to the erythema and do not blanch. Third degree, full thickness, and fourth degree burns require surgery and, paradoxically, usually present with almost no pain. Natural wound healing involves four phases: hemostasis, inflammation, proliferation, and remodeling. Hemostasis involves clot formation at the injury site and is immediately followed by the recruitment of inflammatory cells in the inflammation phase. Inflammation is characterized by the release of cytokines and chemokines and removal of debris and pathogens. Proliferation involves the recruitment and activation of fibroblasts and keratinocytes to the wound site, which leads to the replacement of the provisional matrix with a connective tissue matrix, granulation, angiogenesis, and epithelialization. Finally, remodeling involves maturation of granulation tissue, ECM remodeling, and increased tensile strength. Growth factors play a crucial role in wound healing, including PDGF, EGF, TGF-beta, IL-1, IL-8, TNF, IGF, VEGF, HGF, and FGFs. The length of healing depends on various factors, including injury severity, inflammatory cascade activation, and nutrition. Severe burn injury induces a complex response involving the release of stress hormones and pro-inflammatory mediators. The initial response is a hypometabolic response that lasts for 72 to 96 hours, that is the ebb phase, before turning into the flow phase that can persist for years. Stress mediators such as catecholamines, glucocorticoids and cytokines cause systemic responses including increased heart rate and circulation. Protein is degraded to deliver energy for hepatic function while the gut develops mucosal atrophy to absorb more nutrients but also enabling bacterial translocation. The kidneys are hyperperfused but oxygen delivery is decreased leading to acute kidney injury and stress signals from the kidney. White adipose tissue changes to brown adipose tissue releasing energy and inducing substantial lipolysis with accompanying expression of lipotoxic intermediates transferred to the liver. The liver develops hepatomegaly and is unable to metabolize all accumulating substances leading to hyperlipidemia and hyperglycemia with insulin resistance worsening the hypermetabolic and inflammatory state. If hypermetabolism cannot be diminished or decreased, holistic catabolism ensues leading to multiple organ failure and death. Tissue injury following severe burns results in the release of endogenous damage-associated molecular patterns, DAMPs, such as mitochondrial DNA and double-stranded RNA, dsRNA. Exogenous pathogen-associated molecular pattern molecules, PAMPs, such as lipopolysaccharides, LPS, and peptidoglycans can also induce vascular leak, an inflammatory response and metabolic changes. Vascular leak and transfer of intravascular fluid to third spaces leads to tissue edema and further injury. The inflammatory response can result in immunosuppression and ineffective response to bacterial invasion. Metabolic changes include increased muscle protein degradation, insulin resistance, and increased cardiac load. These events can culminate in systemic inflammatory response syndrome, SIRS, an inflammatory state affecting the whole body which can lead to multiple organ failure and death. Inhalation injury can be divided into three types: systemic toxicity due to products of combustion, carbon monoxide and cyanide poisoning, upper airway thermal injury, and lower airway chemical injury. Carbon monoxide poisoning is easily diagnosed from the serum carboxyhemoglobin level determined as part of the arterial blood gas measurement at hospital admission. Administration of 100% oxygen reduces the carboxyhemoglobin half-life from 4 hours on room air to about 45 minutes. Even when early intubation is not indicated, 100% oxygen administration should be continued until carboxyhemoglobin levels are confirmed to be less than 5%. Hyperbaric oxygen therapy has been argued to reduce long-term neurological sequelae of carbon monoxide poisoning, but prospective randomized trials have presented conflicting data regarding long-term cognitive function. Cyanide toxicity is often clinically diagnosed by persistent acidosis without another systemic source, and empirical treatment with cyanobalamin has increased despite limited evidence for its safety and effectiveness. Upper airway burns can be diagnosed by assessing symptoms such as hoarseness, stridor or oropharyngeal soot, and examining the posterior pharynx for edema or mucosal slough. Lower airway injuries tend to be due to chemical pneumonitis from products of combustion. Thermoregulation by the oropharynx is sufficient to cool most gases before they reach the distal lung parenchyma, but steam may cause a thermal injury to the lower airways. Lower airway burns can be diagnosed with fiber optic bronchoscopy or by evidence of small airway inflammation and obstruction on COURT. Prolonged mechanical ventilation complicates the care of patients with burn injuries with or without inhalation injury. Patients with inhalation injury are at risk of developing acute respiratory distress syndrome, ARDS, from direct airway injury and increased fluid resuscitation requirements from the inflammatory response to the burn injury. The prevention is done by the Haddon matrix, which is a means of understanding traumatic injury that examines etiological relationships instead of using descriptive terms. This approach is essential to transition from the concept of burn injury as an unpreventable accident to the concept of injury being related to factors that can be modified. For example, instead of viewing a child accidentally turning on hot water in a bathtub as an unpreventable accident, we can shift our focus to factors such as supervision and control of water temperature at the boiler or with a mixing valve. It is important not to assign blame, but to recognize the resources needed or factors that influence the cause of the traumatic event. By examining reasons why the child was unsupervised and how to control hot water, programs can be established to address them. Lund and Browder diagrams are used for estimating burn size in terms of total body surface area, TBSA. In adults, the rule of nines is used to assess the proportion of TBSA affected and to help guide immediate treatment decisions such as fluid resuscitation. However, due to different head-to-body size ratios, the proportion of TBSA affected in children is estimated differently and the rule of nines is inaccurate. The rule of nines and the estimate that each hand comprises 1% of TBSA are also inaccurate in patients with obesity or cachexia. The hand represents 2% of TBSA and can be a useful tool for quick calculation of burn size, especially for irregularly shaped scald burns. Acute care for severe burns can be compartmentalized into 5 distinct phases that overlap during the first days to weeks after burn injury. Phase 1 is the initial assessment and triage, in which the injurious cause is removed and primary and secondary surveys are conducted. Phase 2 focuses on fluid resuscitation to address hypovolemia. In Phase 3, the wound is covered to promote healing and reduce infection risk. Phase 4 focuses on supportive or critical care. If the patient survives, Phase 5 of care focuses on rehabilitation, including physical and mental health support to enable the patient to return to regular life. Sheet grafts are aesthetically pleasing but require a lot of skin and are usually reserved for small burns or complex areas such as the face, hands, and breasts. Full-thickness sheet grafts are used for smaller defects and during the reconstructive phase. Meshed split-thickness skin grafts are usually used to cover larger areas. The goal is to expand the donor skin to obtain greater coverage with ratios of 1 to 1.5, 1 to 2, 1 to 3, 1 to 4 or 1 to 6. The Meek technique uses skin squares spread out to cover large areas, up to a ratio of 1 to 9, and is reserved for extensive burns with sparse donor sites. A freshly meshed split-thickness skin graft heals over time. Skin substitutes deliver proteins, growth factors and/or cells via a delivery vehicle or matrix to form new autologous skin. RECELL is a device that sprays a cell suspension of skin cells onto the wound or grafted area to improve healing and scarring. The skin gun delivers autologous cells and/or stem cells to wounds to improve wound healing but has not yet entered the clinical arena. A handheld device can print 3D autologous skin using microfluidic technology and an ink matrix. A skin substitute using autologous cells from a healthy donor and a matrix shows self-assembly of dermal and epidermal structures and will change burn care delivery. So to summarize, adequate resuscitation in patients with burn injury is challenging and an emerging technology is the burn navigator, which determines resuscitation parameters from urinary output data. Wound coverage can be improved with artificial skin substitutes such as transite, C and cultured skin substitutes, but their application is limited due to cost and availability. Various approaches could change the treatment paradigm for burn wound care, including stem cells, stem cell guns, and 3D printing of autologous cells to recreate a patient's skin and reduce scarring and the need for donor sites. The last phase of burn care, rehabilitation, is becoming one of the most important. Burn survivors have a greater mortality than non-injured counterparts, with the greatest risk during the first year after injury. This increased mortality is related to trauma and mental illness, and burn survivors have considerable care needs that are not being met. Burn survivors also have a decreased quality of life and struggle to adjust to their new life. Long-term studies are needed to better understand how to diagnose, treat, and prevent long-term morbidities. New technologies need to be adopted in all phases of recovery to further improve burn outcomes both acutely and in the long term.